Hi guys, this is Gianfranco with the Leaky Cauldron reporting live from the opening of Harry Potter and the Cursed Child here in San Francisco at the Curran Theater. Stick tuned with us on the red carpet to see who comes our way.
Thank you.
What does that feel like with tomorrow?
It's exciting. It's very exciting. It's great to be in San Francisco. This is our West Coast home, and it's a beautiful theater, and it's very exciting to be here.
Do you know why I love the Leaky Cauldron?
Why do you love the Leaky Cauldron?
Because you are such enthusiasts for everything connected with, obviously, Harry Potter and J.K. Rowling, but also you follow other work. I love the fact that the Leaky Cauldron takes it wider and takes theatre and the arts wider, obviously always feeding back into Potter.
Yes.
But it gives your readers and your fan base a wider context for the world.
That there is more going on in the world of Potter than just Potter.
Yes, and how Potter is feeding all this other work and how we are involved in other stuff. And it's this big ecosystem.
But what's fun though is that there are people who were in the New York production who come. So some of the actors in it were understudies in New York, and then of course Scorpius is played by one of the ushers from the Lyric Theatre. Now how great is that?
For a play whose tagline is sometimes even darkness can be found in unexpected places.
Well,
it's a play that has a lot of light to it.
Oh, of course. I mean that's what Joe does.
Yes.
But you can't have light without dark.
The dark. Yeah.
You can't have sadness without happiness.
Yeah.
You know, unfortunately they coexist. And so the only reason we can be happy at times is because we understand what sadness is.
Of course.
And the only reason why we have to fight the darkness is because we know what it's like when it's light.
One of the great things about the play in this particular time in which we live right now is it is about finding the light and finding through friendship and through family and through people behaving honorably and caring about each other. That's the great, wonderful message, which we need now more than ever. Everywhere.
Yeah.
So it's one of the great, it's the real message at the heart of the play and at the heart of all of J.K. Rowling's work.
Because of it, at its very heart, it's about tolerance, acceptance, kindness,
yes,
and the act of friendship.
Yes.
It is a story that is so universal, as we know. Joe's themes are always universal. But also it's a piece of theatre. It's you know, magical in the most obvious sense. But it's also magical because it's an opportunity for people to come together, families to come together, friends to come together to spend the day and commune, really, and talk and think about their relationships. This play has done so much. I've had so many letters and so many emails from dads who've said thank you for this play. I have found a way to talk to my son that I didn't know how to, and we saw the play together and held hands through it. I mean, that's theatre.
What do you bring to an adult Harry Potter that you think is defining the part?
You know, interestingly enough, I think it's his, he's still dealing with what he went through as a kid. And, you know, I think the great thing about these books is that, you know, as much as they're about magic and wizards, they're about people. And about real people who are going through real things. And Harry is struggling to be a father, struggling to know what it is to be an adult. You know, he's done the greatest things, he saved the world. And life goes on, and how do you sort of cope with that?
Playing the brightest witch of her age, what has Hermione taught you on this journey?
Hermione has taught me to always think, even though McGonagall accuses them of not thinking when they make the terrible mistake that they do, to always think, to always remain calm, and put your best foot forward, I guess. Yeah, I love the character. She's just she's the best friend you could ever have. And she's smart as a whip, and she's feisty, she's spirited. I love her.
Very often Ron sometimes gets written off as the comedic character.
Right.
Well, what do you think you are bringing to the stage as Ron?
I love that question. I think Ron is often the comic relief. And in our show, you know, in a lot of ways, he is that, but it's born out of a certain sort of, like, I think he's kind of come to a place now where he's comfortable with himself, and he's sort of living his dream. He's living the dream. He's got the wife, the love of his life. He's got these two gorgeous kids. He's doing what he wants to do. He didn't want to go into the ministry or be an aura. He wanted to run a joke shop and make people laugh.
Is there anything as a mother or as a minister for magic that you think she still has yet to learn?
That's a really good question. As a mother, you might want to keep track of your kids.
Yes. They're just disappearing.
Yes.
Every 10
They're
minutes.
Disappearing. Like, oh well, that one's gone, or the one doesn't show up at the train station. So, yeah, that would be one thing.
What is Ron teaching you on this train?
Well, I think the best thing I can take from him is to really just kind of, like, chill out a little bit and take it a little easier and know that everything's going to be okay and that friends are the most important thing and that friends and family are really, you know, if you're as rich as you are, surrounded by your friends and family.
On this journey, what have you learned? What does it take to be a member of the Golden Tree?
Wow.
What does it take? I'm still learning that. I don't know. You know, I think the thing about them is that they have so much heart. You know, they really fight for what they believe in all the time.
A lot of faith. I mean, I hadn't read the books when I came to this production. I've been reading them as we've been in rehearsal, and I fell in love with them. And it feels like really big boots to fill because there's so many people out there who have been committed from the first time they cracked open a J.K. Rowling book, and they have their ideas of what that person should be like. And so, I don't know specifically what it takes, but it takes courage, I guess.
Well, for my part, it takes a sense of play. It takes a real knowledge of what these friendships mean to not only the trio, but to everybody. I mean, everybody is so familiar with these three, and really, it's just an honor and privilege to be able to, you know, bring that in front of people every night.
First things first, you started as an usher at the Lyric Theater. Can you tell us a little bit about that journey?
I did, yeah. So I was an usher for the first cast, the year one cast, as they call it. And I was there from March 2018 to March 2019. And then about 6 months into being an usher there, I booked this. So it was kind of amazing and made going to work a lot more fun.
And what's it like looking out on the audience now, being from the stage, having been in the house previously?
It's indescribable. It's, you know, you imagine how these moments are going to be, but you can never fully appreciate what they are to you there, it's happening, and just to be grateful. I mean, grateful every night, because this did not have to happen, and we're here, and we have a beautiful show, and a beautiful cast, and a beautiful city.
Beautiful is the word for it.
We're just so lucky. It's just a beautiful, wonderful experience.
Being the daughter of the brightest witch of her age,
yes.
What do you think Hermione stands to learn from Rose?
I think Rose is a good combination of a puckish sense of fun that Ron has, and like that ambition and that ambition and that drive that Hermione has, and I think that she can toe that line so easily that Hermione can just stand to like let go and see how her daughter just navigates this world. Yeah.
In 2007,
yes,
J.K. Rowling said that Albus Severus Potter was the one character in her entire canon that she wanted to know more about. How does that feel, you know, to bring that character to life for Joe?
That means a lot. I didn't know about that quote. And that's beautiful. It's been such an honor to dive into this character. And how much the story talks about, what the story teaches you about friendship and about love and how that changes you. And Albus changes so much throughout the course of the story because of friendship and because of love. So yeah, that's humbling.
What is your actual house?
My actual house is a Gryffindor, so I'm playing against type here.
Time turners.
Yes.
Yay or nay?
Oh, okay. They're amazing. They're really cool. Do not use them, ever.
Do you foresee Rose, Scorpius, and Albus becoming the new Golden Trio, or
yes.
What is that dynamic that we're
looking at? I think at the very end, she like hints toward it. She's like, okay, we're gonna change it up, but it's only gonna be weird. You let it be weird. Just totally normal. Kind of. Yeah, we're definitely gonna be a trio. Hard at first, but eventually.
It's we're gonna get there. We'll have a whole new series in the works someday.
Oh, that would be fantastic. And that would be fantastic.
Listening, Joe? You listening?
Rose, Scorpius, and Albus.